y'all. Welcome to the river. We are so excited tonight because my sweet baby girl is home for a minute. She comes in town about every 8 weeks, but she has to fly out, I mean, right after we're finished tonight, so we're going to get her singing pretty early. She's an old married gal now, and I tell you what, we love her husband, Joel. He is just wonderful. They're living in Charlotte. You know you love him. But also, we're so excited to have Mark Lowry in the house tonight. We're always thrilled to have Mr. Landy Ewan over there. Mr. Chip Davis is going to be with us, Miss Tabitha Bear, Michael Briggs. I'm telling you what, Aubrey's back with us tonight. It's going to be a good night. And Tim Miner. Listen, let me tell you what, you love us. And Miss LaVon is back tonight, going to be singing as long as she can do. But we're going to get started. Hey, while I'm thinking about it, be sure to share this with somebody. But we're going to get started with a good old Randolph song that says, I Go to the Rock.
Where do I go?
Well,
when there's nobody else to turn to, who do I talk to? When nobody wants to
to suffer rejection and pay for crimes he had not done. That one earthly reason was me.
I was the reason that one earthly reason. I was the
This Weagle thing.
Nobody
right
sings
here.
Like that.
Yeah. There's a song that if Destiny doesn't sing this tonight, I know there will be an uprising by some of you that are watching. Maybe tell them about how you wrote the song. I know you're going to have to fly out here in a minute.
Just talk about it a little bit.
I wrote this song almost 2 years ago now. I locked myself away for a couple days to do some writing, and I showed up with my plan and with the song ideas that I thought that I had, and everything that I thought that I was going to accomplish. And I sat down at the keyboard, and it was like the Lord showed up and completely annihilated any plans that I thought that I had. And there are only two songs in my life that I've ever written from start to finish without any laboring. And this one, when I sat down at the piano, I just began to worship and surrender myself to the Spirit. This song came from the depths of my heart. I will build for you an altar right here on this rugged floor. Make my sacrifices ready.
This land is far from
maybe come back in a couple minutes and sing a little bit more, but I want my little brother to come up. I am so grateful. I'm a little bit mushy today, but maybe because it's my baby's at home, but you know, I want to tell people I love, that I love them while they're around to know it. You know, if you say, well, my mama knows I love her, but I haven't told her in a long time. Baby, get on that phone and tell her. Because one day, she's going to be on the
note. I love you, Mommy.
You are so silly. But I'm serious. I really, really wanted to let people know that I care about them while they're around to know that I care about them. I don't want them to stand around somebody's coffin and say, you know, don't she look natural? No, I want to keep her alive. I want them to know how I feel. And I tell you what, my little brother, many of you know this, some of you don't, because we always have... We have first-time people to view every time. And when I was a kid, I'm an only child, and I used to pray. LeVon, I prayed for a little brother. And when he was 11 years old, and I guess I was about 17, God sent this crazy, wonderful, zany man into my life. And I am forever grateful. Would you please welcome my little bro, Mark Lowry.
Oh! Woo! I love you, Rita, Johnny, and all the sweet people. Here. This is the first song I ever wrote, and I wrote the music because I had to. Well, the story is told in the Bible about a mighty king. How when he was just a little boy, he played around with a swing. Well, he got up early one morning, and before the sun had set that day, a nasty old giant had lost his head, and his body lay cold on the clay. David went to the battlefield, his big brother said, stay away! Business out here, David. Let's go back home and play. Well, but David said, step aside, boys. I'm gonna take that giant on. But his brother said, oh, baby, you're helpless, David. Get back home and you belong. Well, but David said, that giant ain't gonna make fun of my God, King. I'm gonna find me five smooth stones and play a while with my sling. I'm gonna challenge that devil in the name of the Lord. I guess it's history. Little David took one smooth stone and that giant felt like a tree. So when the giant of trouble stands in your way, remember what little David had to say. I see words for this. That giant up there ain't too big to hit. That giant too big to miss. That giant up there ain't too big to hit. That giant too big to miss. So whenever a giant gets in your way, you just remember this. That the God who invented giants is big enough to whip them all. And the stone hurled from the hand of the Lord who made in the giant fall.
That was a rap before rap.
Yeah. I, when they came along with rap, I thought, I did that 10 years ago.
This is I've never sung this here, and I asked if I could sing it because it is my favorite song. And it goes like this. Our sons
And daughters, did you
teach songwriting and do our writing room clinics, there are only 5 songs we use, and none of ours are in it. Maybe that's not a good sign, but we use 5 songs as examples of a perfectly written song. And Mary, Did You Know is number 1 on that list, because not only is the lyric so perfect, but Buddy Green, the lyric which you wrote, and the music that Buddy Green wrote for, I mean, what a beautiful marriage of melody, of chords, and of lyric. And I love, that's my favorite. It's just about my favorite song. Although I love Destiny, She Starts With the End in Mind is like real close second to that one. I am so excited because we are having, I have 2 microphones, so I guess I need all that. But Aubrey's going to come and sing for us. sweet little Aubrey, she doesn't always get to be here because she's getting so in demand around town, y'all. But I want Aubrey to come, and Tabitha's going to come and help her sing. Are you going to help, Mr. Chipper? You are? Okay. We're so happy. Yay. I'm glad you're home. Glad you're feeling a little bit better. And this little youngin is just a precious, precious thing. What you going to sing, girlie? Talk about it.
I'm going to sing one I've sung before. It's still one of my favorites. I'm going to sing, Lord, I hope this day is good.
Where's Gordon? He don't care. He don't care.
Lord, I hope this day is good. I'm feeling empty and misunderstood. I should be thankful, Lord, I know I should. But Lord, I hope this day is good. Lord, have you forgotten me? I've been praying to you faithfully.
Kitchen. Y'all didn't know we're in my living room. Kitchen's right there. But actually, Des said today, I want us to sing this song together. And if I had to pick, it'd be really hard to do, but yeah. Out of all the hundreds and hundreds of mom's songs, if I had to just pick one that I'd want to make sure this is the last song I sang, it'd be this one, He Looked Beyond My Fault.
Oh.
So many.
Oh,
song of praise, for it was grace that bought my liberty. And someday I'll know just why he came to love me so. He looked beyond my faults and saw my need.
Just say bye to my baby girl. Come here. I know you love Destiny, and I know you're going to be friends.
I love you.
Love you. Love you. Love you. And did y'all know that Mark is Destiny's godfather? So you got to tell Uncle Chip and all the family about it. We're like the Waltons around here. Tell them goodbye. It's like homecoming, y'all. You got to tell, hug everybody's neck and tell them all goodbye. But I love you, girly girl. Traveling mercies to you as you fly to Charlotte tonight. I want to have LaVon come and sing. It's been really fun to watch y'all's response to LaVon, because I didn't know. Some of y'all are a little classy, whatever. And LaVon is just Pentecostal, here we go. You know, and I love her. We have been friends for many, many, many years. And had a little hand in helping raise her girls up, I believe. And her daughter, Becky, is the one that you love. That's the mama to little Reagan Gray. But we love having LaVon be a part.
And so many more.
Yeah. All five of the young, and she's grandmama too. What you gonna sing tonight, girl?
It's a slow one.
All right, talk a little.
Well, today I work from home, and I was thinking about tonight, and I was thinking about the people that bring their prayer request online, and the Lord just spoke to me, I guess, and he said, you be the one to tear the roof off.
Mm-hmm. Now come on now.
And you be the one to lower them, yeah. Mm. And so this song, it's been a long time since I've done it. You can go ahead, Pastor Bonnie.
Mm-hmm.
beautiful joy. He said, I'll give you joy. You will rise like eagles, and my joy will be your strength. Take me upon you, and I will give you joy.
Precious, precious praying woman. And I want to say a big thank you to, we have a group called the Praying People, and they do some stuff. I mean, they will not let go. They grab the horns of the altar, wherever those are, they grab them, and really just pray. And we want to encourage you, it's okay to leave your request. It's a safe place. Nobody's going to go gossip about your problem. They're going to take it to the Lord in prayer. I want Michael to come and sing some. Have you got your banjo ready? This guy, I know some of you are getting to know, but Michael is all over the city of Nashville, so many different places, heralding the good news of Jesus, and sometimes just good news of love and joy. But we are so proud that Michael is a part of the River family here. And he's just, what you going to sing? Get over here, child.
Banjos usually don't have pickups in them, but mine does, so every once in a while we get a little feedback. This song is called I Was Bound in Chains. I really don't even know what the actual chorus or it just kind of came out the way it came out. And I wrote this song because I've just been telling my story of redemption and freedom from growing up in a cult, and so this song kind of celebrates that. And my book should be out middle of October or so. So it's called From Cult to Country, so hope to share that with you all as well. Now we're going to turn this amp back on. I was bound in chains. you all.
Oh, thank you. I can't wait for this book to get out. I want Tabitha Fair. I want our sweet little Tabby to come over here. And Chipper. Poor Chip. We call him everything. Chip, Chipster, Chipper. He answers to them all. And we're going to sing another, or she's going to sing another Donnie Rambo song, one of my favorites. It says, Sheltered in the Arms of God.
I feel the touch.
Thank you.
Rambo still speaks.
Yes, she does.
Still tells things to us. Yes. And y'all, she is there. She has found her treasure at the feet of the Lord Jesus, and we're headed there too. I am so thankful. I'm 60 now, Reba. I am in the AARP crowd. And I'm thrilled to be here. Can't wait to see what God's got for me. And listen, you watching, God's got stuff for you too. Check your pulse. If you got a pulse, God ain't through with you. Right? Am I getting in front of you?
Are you checking my pulse? Checking
my pulse. So I just want to say, y'all, we ain't far from home. Don't give up yet. Don't throw in the towel. Just because you know, a lot of these young people these days are, I'm seeing a lot of them leave the faith. And they don't believe anymore. And it's breaking my heart. And don't throw the baby out with the bath. Listen, all of our forefathers, they handed us the Word of God, but they got their fingerprints all over it. So we spend our lives sometimes wiping off the fingerprints, but don't throw the book away. Don't throw God away, y'all. Wipe off the fingerprints. You know, they told me long hair was wrong. And I learned that long hair, God didn't care about long hair on men. 1 Corinthians 11:14, doth not even nature itself teach you shame for a man to have long hair. Man, they preached that to us, and that was a cornerstone. That one day I realized God didn't really concern about that, and I had to remove that cornerstone. Now let me tell you something, my building shook. I had to deconstruct. I took that cornerstone out. And then I found out the rapture, you know, who cares one way or the other. I mean, if that was a cornerstone for us. Now listen, y'all, have no cornerstone but Jesus. No cornerstone, because that way your building won't shake so much when you realize the forefathers, sometimes tradition was just a bad habit.
That's right.
So listen, don't give up on God, though. You young people, any young people watching, I'm talking to you. Don't throw Him away.
Come on.
Listen, after what He's done for you, you have tasted of the heavenly gift. You have tasted of that heavenly gift. You have experienced Him. Don't deny Him now. And that's all I have to say about that.
You going to be able to say like this?
Come on, baby.
She, yeah, one more time.
This is probably my favorite Daddy Rambo song. I mean, there's a lot of them, but this one always got to the heart, especially when she sang it. So I'm sure glad she wrote it.
Yes.
I boast not of words, nor tell of good deeds. For naught have I done to merit His grace.
Sing, Chip.
All glory and praise, it shall rest upon Him. So willing to die in my place, I will glory in the cross, in the crossless suffering on the end. And I will weep.
Great job, Chip. I want Tim Meyer to come.
Yeah.
I know we're going a little bit long. And y'all, I forgot to even tell you because I wasn't quite sure, but Jonathan Martin is here tonight. And we're just going to have him kind of share in a minute a little condensed version of whatever he was going to share. But I want to mention to you, anytime, please send your prayer requests. They'll be prayed over all this week and next week. But I want, this child is like another one of my youngins. And this is one of the most talented.
He's too old to be one of our youngins.
No, he's not.
Yes, he is. He is too.
But Tim Miner, I tell you what, Donnie and I have so grown to love this young man, and we're excited about some of the work that we're doing together, some of the writing we're doing together. It's fun. But I tell you, we're just kind of dragging them out tonight, aren't we? This is a Bill Gates. Is this what you're going to sing, son?
Not Bird.
Well, he's going to do.
Do what you do.
He's
going to
do what you do.
Thing together at a friend of his church, and I said, why don't we do that song, Because He Lives? That is such a beautiful song, and it is a Gaither song after all, so we're going to do that for you. They kind of do, actually.
Yeah.
God sent His Son. They called Him Jesus.
How sweet to hold.
joy he gives. But greater still, the calm assurance this child can face uncertain days because he lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow.
Mondays with Mark, that Mark does every Monday night. The writers of that song, Will and Gloria, were on Mondays with Mark. I encourage you to go look it up and get that interview because it was just absolutely wonderful. I'm going to have Jonathan come up. Is that what we're doing next? I want to have Jonathan come up. You know, it's just right now, it just seems like there's a kind of a weight of prayer. But we have missed Jonathan. He's been out of town. He's a busy, busy man. But Jonathan is so much a part of the heart of the river. And I want you to be encouraged. Life is worth the living because he lives. It seems like the past two or three weeks, there's been some of you that have been struggling with suicide, that I'm aware of situations. Can I tell you, hold on. Like Mark was saying, just hold on. Can you take five more minutes and just hold on?
Yeah.
And know that there is a future and a hope, and life is worth living because he lives, because he conquered death, hell, and the grave. He rose up. If he had just died, that would have been something, but there were a lot of people that died.
Yeah.
But he came back. He rose from the dead.
Yes, he did.
Defeated it. He kicked the devil's face. And life is worth the living.
Yeah.
I'm so excited. There's a young man that I'm close to that is 2 weeks sober. You say, well, that's not a big deal. Oh, yes, it is. You don't understand. When you have been at the point of suicide and now you're 2 weeks in your right mind, can I tell you, that's worth rejoicing over. Some of you are going through some stuff, but can I tell you, it's going to turn around because he is the God of the turnaround. He is the Lord of the breakthrough. So you keep on pressing into Jesus because he is the answer. Jonathan, tell me, just say whatever's on your mind.
Well, it's so sweet to be back with my river family. I have been gone the last couple weeks. This time last week I was riding scooters with Mark in Houston. That was amazing.
I just dropped that on my mic. I'm sorry, Rita.
That's okay.
I'm going to jump right in though, and not visit or be funny or whatever, because I'm really feeling emotional in this moment. You know, Reba, Mark said something when he was just kind of exhorting us a couple moments ago, and then for you to say what you did, I don't have a clue what you're talking about. I've not been here, been in Cincinnati, Houston, all over the place, not been in town for 2.5-3 weeks or whatever. I didn't know there were any stories, prayer requests, whatever, but I absolutely feel like the Lord gave me a word about this.
Good.
about suicide, about despair.
Come on.
I mean, I don't even know when I've ever given a talk specifically about any of that, like this. But it felt so directed. I'll start this way. Two nights ago, I had a dream. I'm not a person that... I have dreams. I have a lot of dreams. I don't claim to have a lot of spiritual dreams. And I don't know that, and I don't know what this means or if it has to mean anything. But I'll just say it was unusual for me in that it was so vivid and coherent to remember it in such great detail when I woke up. I had a dream that I was getting ready to speak at something like, when I grew up going to Church of God, Cleveland, Tennessee, youth camps. Youth camp was a big deal, and because we were, you know, old-time Pentecostals, a lot of stuff happened and demonstrative things, and lots of wonderful. I was preaching at something like a youth camp. It was something. It was like that kind of setting, but there were people that were there from like all generations of my life, all stages and phases. And in the dream, it's like I had this mandate to preach on the unconditional love of God, which is something I talk about a lot because I don't know what else I would talk about. If you're a preacher, I don't know why you'd be talking about too many other things. It is what I talk about. But I've never spoken about it like I did in that dream. It was like in the dream, there was something on me to preach God's love in such a way to where people were just drinking it up, and I could watch them change while it was happening. It was like I wasn't, it wasn't just talking about the love of God. It was like prophetically declaring it into them, and people were just, just lapping it up. Mm-hmm. And I don't even know exactly how to describe this. It's going to sound weird to you because it was kind of weird to me, but it was like people, it had nothing to do with me. It's like people were so intoxicated on the love of God. They were just out of it. We had a, again, this is all a dream. There were these prayer people that had been assigned that in the end to pray with anybody who wanted prayer. And they couldn't pray for the people who wanted prayer because they themselves were so intoxicated with God's love, they couldn't move. We had to call in extra prayer people because even the prayer people were so overwhelmed by God's love. And it was like as I was declaring God's love, there was just an unction on it for people to receive it in a way that they had never received it before. Specifically, though, in the dream, I had this specific image that while I was talking about God's love, I was seeing, so again, it sounds like Inception now, a dream within a dream, if you know that film. But it's like as I was preaching God's love into people, I specifically saw images of people who were in the room who were at a place of giving up on their own lives. And for some it was in the future, for some it might be moments from the past, but it's like I could see that word reaching into that moment and coming back into people's lives in a moment. It was very strange, very interesting. I woke up in tears because it was so palpable what I felt then, just this release of God's love into the lives of people who were in a place of just utter and complete despair. And again, not knowing any of the particular situations you were talking about, I will tell you this. I don't think, and it's funny, it's interesting to feel led to do this now because I feel like there's been such a lift on the night and a sense of glory and grace in the night. But I think it makes it all the better because everybody feels safe. And I hope if you're watching this, I hope you feel safe right now.
Yes, yes.
I've just never known a moment in my life, in my short 40 years of history, that feels as heavy as this one does now. It's just heavy. Yeah. Every day is heavy. And the news is heavy. And for all the conversation right now around sexual assault, for people who I know who have been sexually assaulted, that's triggering all kinds of things and memories and feelings. And I don't know. I just feel like maybe there's such a... I've talked before here about the shaking, but really, I mean, you know, people don't know who to trust. People don't know who to believe. They don't know if they can believe their leaders. Whether it's anything from the sex scandal within the Catholic Church to the kind of conversations I was just talking about to just in general institutions and politics, nobody knows who they can trust. Right. And I just, I've never talked to as many church leaders as I am right now, or even church leaders and pastors who are saying to me, and I love the candor and appreciate the honesty, I don't know what it is exactly we're doing and if it's making any kind of a difference at all.
Right.
I mean, I just think, especially at a time when there's such a relentless onslaught of information, just nonstop, yeah. we're taking so much more into our brains than we know what to do with. We don't have the emotional bandwidth. We do not have the capacity to carry all the information that we're carrying. We get more information in a day than people used to would have got in a year of their lives. We get it in a day.
Right.
We're overwhelmed by it. We don't know what to do with it. We're incapacitated by it. And I just feel like there's something right now about the moment we're in where it seems like so many people are just overwhelmed by despair. A sense of hopelessness.
Yes.
What does any of this mean? Where is any of it going? What does it matter? And I will give that, I want to say very clearly here that I'm a person who very much believes in and takes seriously that there is such a thing as a very chemical reality of depression. And sometimes yes. it takes medication to deal with that, and praise God for that.
Yeah. Yes.
But beyond particular individuals who have those kinds of intrinsic proclivities, I just feel like right now, it feels like there's such a assignment of despair, an assignment.
Yes.
For even people who haven't really known what it is to be in some of those dark places, are feeling pulled into them right now. And this will be a brief word. I got one verse and this is it. I don't know when I've ever felt a verse as strongly as I've felt this. Never talked about it. I don't remember thinking about it before today.
Wow.
But Psalm 118, verse 17 simply says, I will not die, but live and tell the works of the Lord.
Come on.
Yes.
And that's the whole thing I have to say. I will not die, but live
Come on.
To tell the great works of the Lord.
Yes.
I hate that.
Yes.
I'm not telling you yes. that you're not going to die ever.
Yeah.
But here's the great thing, about dying. It's really not up to you. That's in God's hand. That's in God's timing. If you're not here, I'm sorry, if you are still here, I'm presuming you're supposed to be here.
Right.
If you're alive and you're in the moment, it's because God wants you to be in this moment. Mm-hmm. And when it's your time, it's your time. And what can we do about that?
Right.
But in the meantime, I just feel like somebody needs to hear this tonight. Like, have you ever... Sometimes I like a bad ending. I'm all right with that sometimes. But have you ever seen, I'm in the mood for it. But have you ever seen a movie that just had a really terrible ending where everything inside of you said, it's not supposed to end like this.
Right, come on.
It can't end like this. That's the kind of unction I feel for particular people right now. Just a sense of, it can't end like this.
Come on.
It's not supposed to end like this.
Yeah.
To quote a great U2 song, sometimes you do get stuck in a moment. Mm-hmm. And I speak this from experience. When you're in the middle of a dark moment, it doesn't matter if you got a great family, friends who love you, it doesn't matter if you're making money or what. When you are in that moment, there are some moments in our lives where we just get stuck in a place. It's a cycle inside your head you just can't get out of. And when you're in that moment, sometimes you can't will yourself past just the emotional reality of that. I know what it's like to be in a moment of feeling such utter despair that you cannot conceive of a future. I mean, that is actually the textbook definition of depression. You're not able to conceive of a future. And I just really felt like I need to tell somebody tonight that while it might feel like right now you don't have a future, and I would want to honor the weight of that moment. You know, I get it. Like, if you're in it, I'm not trying to minimize anything. I understand that it can feel like that.
Right. Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
I understand what that's like. I understand that you can't always just snap out of it. But I also want to tell you that feeling is a lie.
Yeah.
Come on.
There is a future.
Yes.
There is more.
Come on.
Yes. Yes.
I'm not saying it's the future.
Yes.
That you once thought it was going to be.
Yeah.
Because there are some things in our lives that we think are going to go on forever that actually do meet an end. But that doesn't mean your story's over.
That's right.
Right.
Just
Come
because
on.
It's not turning out the way that you planned doesn't mean the story's over.
Yes.
Come on,
Jonathan.
Just because the relationship is over doesn't mean that you're over.
Right.
Just because that person walked away doesn't mean that God has walked away from you.
Oh, yes.
If the tribe that you've been with has abandoned and forsaken you and thinks that you've gone off the slippery slope in whatever direction, I've got news for you. God has another tribe.
That's right.
God has another people.
Yes.
Where you're not going to feel weird and strange. Those people are out there.
Yes.
And those people are going to find you and you're going to find them.
Yep.
I feel a burden tonight in particular for some of the folks who are watching who are a little bit older, who feel like the glory days are behind them and that you have nothing left to give. And the world does seem like it's spiraling out of control. And I want you to hear me tonight. There's a calling on some of you to be fathers and mothers.
Come on, yes.
To a generation, to people right now, you don't feel like you have anything to offer. And it's a fine line, right? Because I love humility, but sometimes that can be crippling. That sense of, well, who am I? I'm telling you, there are riches and treasures and resources that God has placed inside of you that the world needs.
Yes.
That a generation of sons and daughters need. We need you to be here. We need you to be here.
Yes, that's so good.
Bringing up the conversation about sexual assault, I want you to hear tonight whether or not, whether you're a product of some kind of abuse, whatever has been done to you, and for that matter, whatever it is that you have done. Don't you dare think for just a moment, for even a minute, that there's any of that where the love of God is not greater and stronger.
Come on, Jonathan.
Do not let that shame be so crippling and so pervasive that you don't believe that God loves you and God can use you. Oh my goodness. The folks I know in my own life in recent years who I've had the conversation so struggling with some issue around sexual identity, ready to, just at the end of their rope. And I want you to hear me tonight that God is so much bigger than any of that.
True.
Please stay here.
Yes.
Please don't go anywhere.
Please.
Come on.
Just stick around. See, that's the thing. You know, I'm all for, praise God, every once in a while we did like a victory talk and good speech and rah, rah, ree, let's go get them. And that's great. But I'm going to tell you something. Some days, you're doing a really good job to get out of the bed.
Yeah.
And you ought to be commended for that.
Yes.
I know sometimes we'll say like, well, God doesn't mean for you just to survive. I've had some moments in my life where surviving was no small thing.
Come on now. That's the truth.
Not hiding my head under the covers for 48 hours was no small thing. Like engaging the world, getting outside of the house, no small thing.
True.
And I just want to encourage somebody with that right now. Sometimes staying alive is a big deal.
Yes, sir.
And we need you to do it.
Yes.
We need you to still be here.
Yes.
I promise you, I don't know when it's coming or how it's coming. And it feels a little bit foolish to say because I can't engineer the moment, but I still believe this principle is true. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes
in the morning.
Yeah. Not every morning. I've had some mornings where I hated the sounds of the birds. I've had those mornings too, but I'm telling you, that dark night of the soul, it does come to an end. And sometimes it, amen. Sometimes it comes to an end in a way that it's totally unexpected and random. Sometimes the circumstances don't change and nothing in your life technically gets one bit better. And yet somehow the cloud just lifts.
Yes.
And you're back. And you're just back. I promise you. Don't get legalistic on me and with my language here. Let me say it like this. I swear to you, if you will stay in the ring,
come on,
you will see the faithfulness of God. I love this language from the Psalms. In the land of the living.
Yes.
In the land of the living.
Yes.
Yes.
I'm all for the hope of life after death, but I'm not talking about heaven right now. I'm talking about seeing the hand of God in the land of the living. He's not done fighting for you. This is not the end of your story. This is not the end of your journey.
Amen.
And I promise I'm about to stop. I mean, this isn't even a sermon. I mean, all I'm doing is trying to say one simple thing. Please stay here a little while longer. And whatever it takes to stay afloat, whatever it takes to stick around, I'm in favor of that. Within reason, whatever small thing you can cling on to, whatever small thing brings you hope right now, just to make it through the night. There is more than just this moment. And so now I don't know what all that dream was about the other night, but I'd love to have the opportunity just to be able to speak prophetically God's love into you right now. I want you to hear that even at your darkest, at your worst, at your lowest moments, you are God's beloved son, you are God's beloved daughter, in whom he is well pleased. He delights in you, he sings over you, he knows everything there is to know about you, he knows every shameful, embarrassing moment, he knows every secret that you want to hide, and he loves you perfectly. And he's embracing you now. He's holding you now. So, Father, I just ask now, in the mighty name of Jesus, God, I pray that for those who right now who are underneath that cloud, and some people know uniquely what I'm talking about, Father, I ask in the strong name of Jesus that you would break the bands, break the strongholds of depression in Jesus' name. Break that despair. I pray that where there have been those sons and daughters of yours who have not been able to conceive of a future, let them right now glimpse hope in a future. Even if it comes in an unexpected way. In fact, it will come in an unexpected way. Oh God, that you would open up our eyes and you would let us see. We're not willing to leave anybody behind. We're not willing for anybody to be left out. We're not willing for anybody to be left on the battlefield. Lord, we just take those sons and daughters and we commend them to your presence. We lift them to you. And I ask now, God, pour your love. The words of the Apostle Paul, that your love would be shed abroad in their hearts. I pray for a peace that passes all understanding to guard their hearts and minds by Christ Jesus now. And Lord, we just declare together now finally that we will see your faithfulness in the land of the living.
Yes.
That we're going to live and not die.
Yes.
In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. I'm going to turn it back over and let you sing whatever you want to sing, but I feel like I need to say it one more time. And I'm not always the person to have everybody claim the promises, but some of you, I would even encourage you, I'll go back to the text one more time. I think it'd be good. Can we just say this out loud in here? We're a small room in here, but this feels like it needs to be declared. I will not die but live. Can we say that?
I will not die but live.
And tell of the works of the Lord.
And tell of the works of the Lord.
Just that first part one more time. I will not die but live.
I will not die but live.
You're not supposed to go out like this. This is not your time. This is not that time. Stay in the ring. Stay in the fight. Even if you don't feel like holding on, I'm going to tell you right now, he's holding you. You don't have to hold on. You can let go and be held right now. This is not about your willpower. This is about the sustaining love of God. You're going to live and not die in Jesus' name.
Yes, amen.
Wow, Jonathan.
Jesus. You will live and not die. You will live to tell of the goodness of your God.
Yes, ma'am.
We said it's all part of your story. Donnie and I the other day were talking about some of our story. I'm telling you, it's a page turner. It really is. Some of the darkest times when it seemed like there was no way. But Jesus.
Come on. But Jesus.
But God.
But God. Yes.
And here we are. Here we are. I'm going to be 67 next month. Here we are declaring the goodness of God because he's been faithful. Don't quit now. Don't go out like this. Because glory, there's one scripture in Psalm in the Message, it keeps saying glory is just around the bend.
Come on.
Glory is just around the bend. Resurrection is just around the bend. The answer is on its way. You know, when we used to mail a lot of cards out, and my one friend would say, I thought you sent me a card. I said, I sent it. It's on its way. I went to the post office. I mailed it. I know. I'm trusting it's on its way. If you're in a room with somebody look at them and say, the answer is on its way. The check's in the mail. The answer is coming. And I am so grateful. Don't you dare do something stupid. Don't you dare do something stupid. Because look what you've missed. All those years ago when I had a gun to my head, 40 years ago, look what I'd have missed. I'd have missed you. I'd have missed all this fun. Hold on.
Yes.
Hold on. Because joy's coming in the morning. Hold on. Don't you dare give up. Don't you dare give in. You better hold on.
Come on.
To every promise of God.
Yes.
Ooh, I feel a release.
Come on.
I feel peace.
Come on.
I feel hope springing alive in you.
Yes.
Hold on. You know, I like sometimes late at night we'll watch some of those old Law and Order and into those things, because you can kind of, it's kind of no-brainer. You kind of know how it's going to go. And just about the time you think the bad guy's going to kill the good guy,
yeah,
all of a sudden, here comes the cops. Here comes the good guys. And suddenly, in a moment, everything turns. I just feel that suddenly moment about to happen for you, that suddenly.
Yeah.
You know, we used to say with the cowboys and the Indians that the Calvary was coming over the hill. Well, can I tell you that Calvary is coming over the hill?
Yes, he is.
The cross is coming over the hill for you. Jesus is coming to rescue you. And I tell you what, I feel a victory in the house tonight.
Yes.
And I know that our prayer warriors are going to continue to pray for you and believe with you and declare the word of God over you. We don't just keep asking, asking, asking. We do that for a while. But then we just start thanking, thanking, thanking God that he has heard our prayer. Do you believe that? I know you do. Well, what a wonderful night with all these great friends. Thank you, Mark Lowry. Love you so much. Thank you, Tammy. Thank you, Chip. Thank you, Jonathan. Thank you, Michael. All these guys. You know, thank you. Thank you, Tim and Edward, for cooking food for us tonight. Thank you, Dan, for running everything. Thank you, LaVon, for singing. Thank you. Thank you, Danny, for just getting LaVon over here.
Yeah.
All of us, all of you. We love you. God has joined you to this thing for a reason. You say, what's the reason? I don't know. I don't even have to. All I know is God is up to something, and it's good.
Yep.
It's good. Keep us in prayer. Thank you, Becky, for being here and helping me, sweetheart. Such good people. Be grateful for those that are around you that help you. Don't just look for their faults. You get what you look for. Look for the goodness in them. Look for the best in them. And call it out in Jesus' name. Lord willing, we'll be back next Tuesday night. Make sure you watch Mondays with Mark. Make sure you watch Dinner Conversations. Make sure you join his YouTube channel. Everything he does is just delicious. It's wonderful. It really, really is. See you next Tuesday. If God puts it on your heart to be a partner with the river, just go to therivergathering.org. Therivergathering.org. And that would be a blessing to us. You want to know something about the music? Go to Rambo-McGuire. We bless you. We love you. We thank you. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. And God is good all the time. All those things that we used to say, you know what? They really do get down inside you. God is good all the time. Let everything that has breath, what are we going to do this week? We're going to praise the Lord. We love you. God bless.